ridiculous. I mean, I get a lot of hate comments where, you know, they'll call me coon. They say I hate myself. I want to be white. All these different things. It's the one part is like me speaking this way or speaking, I guess, I don't want to say proper English per se, but I'm trying to be white. I'm trying to be something I'm not. And it's like, why are you fitting people, a race in a group? You're just allowing white people just to say, well, black people are just dumb. Because if you say we all act the same way and we should all think the same way, that means every black person can be explained with one statement. That's not fair. Let us all be individuals. In fact, you should be fighting for us to be individuals and have our own ideas. Why are we trying to form groups? And then, you know, they wonder why there's all these like white supremacist groups forming up. Because you've already, it's a sides thing. You said there's our side and there's your side. So they're like, okay, sure, we'll form a group, I guess, and go against you. But yeah, I mean, a lot of the hate comments are just useless. I ignore the epithets, but I do try to understand a lot of the criticism. And again, it's just not understanding where I'm coming from. It's not, you know, getting their stats from the right place. The root.com or Onion is not somewhere to get your facts from. But
I like that you compared those. Yeah. That's
pretty funny. But when I, you know, get into a detailed discussion with a lot of them, then they understand where I'm coming from. And it's like there's this light that kind of shines. And I do that at my school a lot as well, where someone that absolutely hates me, I'll spend a whole day talking to them. And at the end, I call it like, it's really awful to use this conversion therapy, which is awful to say that.
You're not electrocuting them.
No. Okay. But by the end of it, it's like their minds are blown because they just believed everything Black Lives Matter said, everything the mainstream left media have said. So you just got to talk to them. They don't want to talk. They're stuck in an echo chamber.
Yeah. Do you see this intersectionality and this combining of perceived oppressions something that will just sort of crap out under its own weight? So like, for example, if you're going to keep saying, well, black people should, or this minority, whatever that minority is, should get easier entrance to this or access to this or whatever, what you're actually saying is, well, other people are going to have to be punished based mm-hmm. on their immutable characteristics. We see this now. I mean, I see a massive split happening mm-hmm. with the Asian community right mm-hmm. now in America, because by every metric that we judge success, they are succeeding at extremely high levels because of hard work and education and commitment to family. But if you're going to start saying, well, we're going to have to take less of them because we have to take more of other people, you're actually setting these groups to hate each other.
Yeah.
That is so dangerous.
Exactly. And you're telling one group that they can't do it on their own. And there are some studies, I forgot who wrote it, but it was called the mismatch theory, which is a lot of the minority students are getting thrown in universities or they're not qualified actually turn out worse. When they come out, they don't get jobs because they don't have the actual skills that they needed to get in. But yeah, it creates this kind of tension. Why would you tell someone that, you know, they're more important just because of the color of your skin? It's going to piss other people off. I don't think that's a way to move forward. I don't think that's a way to progress. But yeah, and the whole intersectionality thing, it's ridiculous. The Pride Parade, I guess, in Toronto is an example of that. It's like, my issues are more important. And then obviously the LGBTQ community, they all hated that. And they were all very upset with it because it's like, Pride is one of the most inclusive, you know, events in the city. Like, why are you trying to ruin it and say this is a black thing? It's an everybody thing. We're all advocating for everyone here. So they're going to ruin themselves if they keep just batting each other.
Speaking of that, I saw the thing that you did. You were not happy when they put the black and brown stripes into the rainbow flag, which I also thought was completely ridiculous. The whole point is that this is for everybody. We're mm-hmm. not looking at all your differences and all your races.
Yeah. But that's one thing. It's like reverse segregation. I really don't get it. The white privilege conference at Ryerson University, that's reverse segregation. And I actually gave them the benefit of the doubt. I'm like, I'm going to ignore the name. I'm going to actually try to see what they're trying to teach. And ultimately, the conclusion of this event was listen to people. Listen to what people are saying. So anecdotes, only listen to people's their feelings. Yeah. So it's like, that's not how you form a society. It's the majority were white women that were just sitting there hearing black people tell them, just listen to our stories because we know and we experience it. And you know, we have to have, you know, black spaces. In fact, there's someone that tweeted during the event saying, a woman just rose her hand to speak while white-splaining. Wait for later where we have our white corner so we can talk about, you know, our... What is this? What kind of society are we preparing ourselves for? It's literally reverse segregation, or segregation in the true sense of the word. And I really don't get it.
What do you make of the guilty white allies? Mm. Those people, you know, when I've had, I know you met Brett Weinstein from Evergreen and Heather, his wife. One of the things that fascinated me most when he was going through the ordeal there was that he said he never feared the black students mm-hmm. physically or the brown students or whatever. Mm-hmm. It was the white allies, he said, that had this sort of look in their eye, like they were the ones that could get violent. Mm-hmm. And I've seen that look. What do you make of that sort of ginned up hatred?
Because it's hard to because if you're not black, then I mean they're trying to explain it. If you're not black, then you don't experience it. Then you don't understand it. So as a white ally, you have to just take everything an activist says to you as fact, as this is what is happening. One of the speakers, actually, he did an interview for the Toronto Star, and they asked him, and I was like, okay, what? Where do you see white privilege in Toronto? And he said, literally, I mean, I'm paraphrasing here, but he said, when you walk into a store. Black people have to think about the fact that people are watching them. Okay, sure. I was like, fine, whatever. But apparently black people have to pay for items in one section before they can move to another section so they don't get accused of stealing. That's his he got a chance to tell us what white privilege is, and that was his example of white privilege.
Is that happening in Canada?
No, it's never happened. I've worked retail for like the most of my life. What, you're gonna like pay in the kids section before you go to the men's section? Like, what world is this guy living in? It blew my mind. And another one, you know, did an article where it's how the outdoors is racist and how, you know, people feel like the, you know, skiing and hiking and everything is a white space and therefore black people don't want to go to it. And it's like, who, you're saying it. You are the one that are making these claims. Why are we there? It's just more division. It's more like, it pisses me off.
Yeah. You know what? Because you're visiting LA for a couple of days. I don't have a ton of time, but maybe we could go on a quick hike and see what happens when a white guy and a black woman go on a hike.
Yeah, exactly. But it just, like, you obviously don't care about the betterment of the black community because you wouldn't be talking about these non-issues. Here in the States, you can talk about, you know, how the education system works. You can talk about the war on drugs. You can talk about the prison system. But yet, the amount of people they got to protest the Trayvon Martin, you know, shooting, if you can get that many people to protest the war on drugs, you can probably make a change. But no, they're going to focus on, you know, I think police shootings is one of the least things that are actually affecting black Americans. But yet, that's what they want to put their focus on.
So how much of the root of that is just lazy thinking? Like, it's easy to get people ginned up about a shooting per se, mm-hmm. and I'm not diminishing the ones that are wrong,
for
obviously.
Sure. Obviously, it's all making it clear.
But it's easier to take all of the anecdotal stuff, the woman at the shopping center who this happened to or that.
Yeah.
It's always easier to do that than to really be like, let's really look at the prison systems, which I would be for looking.
Yeah.
I would be figuring out ways that we can do better education to minority communities that have been neglected, all of those things. But those things aren't really sexy. They're not like the things that get people out on the streets for more than a day. It's the other stuff. Mm-hmm. So part of this is just human nature, right?
Yeah, I totally agree. I mean, I can base all my arguments on anecdotes, but that means nothing to me. I can just say, oh, well, this one day, I've lived in Toronto all my life and I've never experienced racism. I'm not gonna use that as fact. But yeah, but it's so much easier to do so. It's so much easier to, you know, play with the heartstrings and say, like, this is what's really happening. But it's just sad that there are actual policies that, you know, can be changed or put in place that could actually uplift the black community. But, you know, none of the people that claim to be the activists care. And especially the celebrities, which really annoys me. Beyonce and Jay-Z, all they do is talk about, you know, black rights and blah, blah, blah. Why don't you use your $1 billion to, you know, create some rehabilitation center for people that are getting out of prison? Why don't you try to fight for the war on drugs? Like, it's all these things where it's easy just to say, oh, look, there's a shooting. You know, this is what black people experience every day. And, you know, white people are racist. The end. No, it's easier for them to just to say, look at this anecdote and this shooting, and that's what's affecting us. But there's so many other things that could be done.
Yeah, I think you saw a little bit of my appearance at University of New Hampshire when those kids were yelling at me, and when that one woman, who I don't think was a student, I think she was either a mother of a student or an advisor or something, when she kept saying, you know, these kids, pointing to the black kids, could get shot when they walk out of here. She's talking about at University of New Hampshire. Mm-hmm. And it's like, I actually, that was one of the only moments where I didn't know what to say, because it was so crazy to say that. Like, you're not going to be shot when you walk out of here.
Yeah.
And I think I maybe said something to that effect. But like, it's like, that's really dangerous, that line of thinking.
I totally agree. And I was actually having I went to a comedy club the other day, and there's this guy on stage. He was like typical inner city black youth or whatever. And he, after his set, he came to sit at my table. Everyone was gone. And he made a comment saying, wow, it was really hard to be a black woman in this country. And this is, again, this is Canada. I feel like there's no excuses for Canada. Like, get out of here. And I asked him, okay, how? And he's just like, I don't know. It's really hard to be, you know, a woman and black. I'm like, yeah, I get the whole woman thing because, you know, men are, you know, physically bigger and blah, blah, blah. But why is it hard for me to be black in Toronto specifically? And he's like, you know, because, you know, there's just white privilege. I'm like, no. Give me two reasons. Give me two concrete reasons. Could not come up with one. Because there is, you can't come up with one. You have to use the anecdotes. You have to use the, you know, if you walk out the street, you're going to get shot. Why? What are the statistics of people that get shot by police? Oh, 7 get shot by police per year, and it's not recorded by race, and it also doesn't tell us if they're armed or unarmed. 7 people. And you're telling me you're more likely to walk out the door as a black person and get shot? That's not an epidemic. You know what's an epidemic? The crime in black communities. That's an epidemic. But you want to ignore that and just talk about the other, yeah, anecdotes that pull at the heartstrings and make people feel guilty and... Oh, it's a waste of time. It's such a waste of time.
What are your parents?